Hello and welcome to Frankly Speaking, Mr. Jagan Reddy. It's a pleasure to have you on the show. This is the first time we are talking on Times Now. What's the sense that you're getting? We've seen you through the last year. In fact, the Pad Yatra that you did, the kind of crowds that you got. How do you see this election to be different from the 2014 elections?
2014 election was, if you were to see the numbers then, the difference between winning and losing was less than a percentage. We were around about 44.5%, they were around about 45.5%. And in that 45.5%, what they had everybody. The Modi-ji's euphoria was there predominantly, along with one more actor by name Pawan Kalyan. He was also with them. And most importantly, he never had anti-incumbency then on him. He was also in opposition. And he had his lies. And he lied through his teeth. And today, the situation is totally different. Today, people have seen his governance. People have seen that he lied. And people do not trust him anymore. And the other factors like Modi-ji and all these factors are no longer with him. So this anti-incumbency on him would be so dominant that the results would totally change, because it is anti-incumbency versus hope.
Versus hope. So you're saying Chandrababu Naidu lied through his teeth. What are the lies that you are trying to point out to?
So to begin with, he said, knowing very well that 87,612 crores was the agricultural loans that Andhra Pradesh farmers had during the elections, and in his own manifesto as well, he said he will waive the entire agricultural loans. That is 87,612 crores, knowing very well that no state government will ever have that kind of funds to do it. He lied. Then he said he will waive the entire self-help group loans. That was 14,200 crores then. Even that, he lied. Not a single rupee has been paid. And then he said he would give jobs to every house. If not a job, he said, he would give 2,000 rupees a dole. So 60 months of his regime into 2,000, 1,20,000 rupees, he duped the youth. So at every stage, he said, don't pay up. Farmers who were paying loans, he asked them not to pay.
But is that the way governance should be done? That people who take loans should not pay up? Can any state allow this to happen?
In fact, last time when Chandrababu Naidu spoke of these promises, we said this cannot be done. I was very sincere in my appeal to people. I said, according to state level bankers committee reports, SLBC reports, the state level bankers committee, periodically they give their reports presented to the chief minister. So anybody who is a politician is fully aware of these state level bankers committee meeting reports. Because these reports are published. And these SLBC reports have clearly spoken and said 87,612 crores are outstanding agricultural loans. Then how can any state government's budget support 87,612 crores of write-offs, knowing very well, yet he promised? And if you were to see his manifesto, it comprises of more than 600 promises. And he breached. He has not even done 10% of those promises. So much so that you go to TDP website and ask for 2014 manifesto. You will not find it in their websites. It has vanished. Because if people see that manifesto, they will literally beat up Chandrababu Naidu.
You're saying that's the kind of anger that you see?
That is the kind of anger, that is the kind of the lies what he spoke about. Why is it that his manifesto 2014 manifesto is not found in his own website. I mean, usually when somebody releases a manifesto, they're proud to publicize it. Why is it that today Chandrababu Naidu is in that position that you don't even find his manifesto, in 2014 manifesto?
So, Mr. Jagan Reddy, in 2014, it was 40.8% votes for the TDP, and you had a higher vote percentage at that time in the Lok Sabha, in the Lok Sabha constituencies, yet you had only 8 seats and he had 15 seats. Look at the assembly, and just as you said, 0.3% divided you in terms of the vote percentage, yet you had 67 seats, he had 102 seats. This time, what's the number that you're putting?
See, the difference is hardly just one, that 1% what we speak of. The halfway mark is what? 87 seats is the halfway mark, 88 is the halfway mark. So we're 67. So we're just 20 short. So had we gotten those 20, the things would have, the entire 175 translates to the 20 seats. Had we gotten the 20, we would have been 80, we would have been 88, they would have been one number short. And if we were to see the number of seats what we lost by less than 2000, would probably compensate for that. But this time, it's, as I've said earlier, it's going to be different. This time, last time with everything going in his favor, that was the percentage what he got. This time, with everything going against him, I'm sure this margin would swell, would widen up. That's what I think.
Mr. Jagan Reddy, you said there was the euphoria of Narendra Modi in 2014. And Modi is the factor that Chandra Babu Naidu actually got advantage of. In 2019, they have both split ways. Chandra Babu Naidu has walked out of the NDA alliance. Do you think Modi factor is something that exists today in 2019, or is it a Rahul Gandhi factor that exists?
I won't comment on this country. Probably when you speak of the country, maybe Modiji's factor is still alive, and maybe after this incident what took place, he's exhibited a stronger will. So probably his ratings might have been the same or probably good nationally. But as far as Andhra Pradesh is concerned, Modi ji will not score well. Neither will Congress. See, as far as Andhra Pradesh state is concerned, let me tell you first about Congress, how it betrayed our state. See, against our wishes, Congress broke our state. And then another sin what was done by them was not incorporating special category status demand into the AP Reorganization Act. At least had they done it, we could have at least gone to Supreme Court. So by not doing so, and by dividing the state against our wishes, Congress has backstabbed us. And as far as Modi ji is concerned, even though he was in power for these 5 years, even though he was in a position to deliver special category status to our state, even though it was a promise made in the parliament, even though BJP put it up in their manifesto, even though Modi ji himself spoke about granting special category status in Tirupati himself, yet he did not deliver. So as far as we are concerned, both the national parties have not done good to our state. And I think this would, the people, I don't speak for myself when I speak these words. So the people of Andhra Pradesh by and large will not go well with any of these national parties.
So are you saying there is possibility of politics at a national level without doing business with either the Congress party or the NDA?
I won't comment on that, because it is for God and destiny to decide that. But definitely, all what we ask is, let it be anybody, we are sick and tired of hearing promises that they will do. All what we are asking, when I speak, I represent the state of Andhra Pradesh. All what we ask is, you sign and I support.
So whoever signs the special status,
I'm with them.
You're with them. Ideology doesn't matter,
nothing.
Standing doesn't matter, nothing matters.
As far as my state is concerned, special category status is more dear to us than anything else. Today our children who completed their education, who have a degree in their hands, they have nowhere to go. You complete your education, you have a degree in your hands, you have nowhere else to go for a job. It took 60 years to build Hyderabad. It took 60, 70 years to build Bangalore. The same with Chennai. So what is it that we can offer more to attract investments into our state? How do we get hotels? How do we get hospitals? How do we get hotels? How do we get hospitals? How do we get IT? How do we get any industry, as a matter of fact? Only when special kind of incentives are given, what come only with special category status. Only special category states give these kind of industrial incentives, like 100% IT exemption, like 100% GST exemption. See, only when you give these kind of special incentives, you can attract somebody to come into our state to set up hotels, to set up hospitals, to set up IT space, to set up industries, to set up factories. Only then you can create jobs for our youth.
But Mr. Jagan Reddy, you know that there are many states which are poorer than Andhra Pradesh, which will need this kind of status. There is the Bihar, the Odishas, you know, there are several poorer states. When the Prime Minister says that he has to look at demands and being just to all states, isn't that something that you should appreciate?
I can't appreciate that, ma'am. Reason being, when our state was divided, weren't these states, what you speak of, the Orissa, the Bihar, or whatever states you have just spoken about, these states were also there then. These states were also present then. And yet, they chose to broke our state with a precondition that they would give special category status to compensate for the loss. And the reason why they took that stand is, this is the only state where bifurcation took place, where the demanding state took away the capital. This is the only instance, you can check the entire history of this country, of bifurcation. This is the only instance where the demanding state took away the capital. And against the wishes of the majority population, the bifurcation took place. This is the only state. And to compensate for this loss, then in those days, the entire ruling party, the entire opposition in the parliament came together. When I meant came together, that means the entire parliament, all the ruling party members, all the opposition party members. There were members in BJP, there were members in Congress, also from Bihar, also from Orissa, also from these other states what you speak of. And there were also so many other parties also present in the parliament then. And yet, they broke the state with a precondition that they would give special category status to Andhra Pradesh as a precondition. And if a parliament given word is not adhered to, if a parliament given word is mocked upon, then where does democracy go?
Mr. Jagan Reddy, on a personal note, let's go down memory lane. I still remember the time that your father actually passed away in that helicopter crash. And we still remember those scenes when you actually, with your mother, went across to 10 Janpath. You met with Mrs. Sonia Gandhi. What really happened? Your father was such a staunch congressman. What really happened between then and now that you're so bitter about the Congress party?
See, the fact is, you know, I am one person who doesn't believe in bitterness. I strongly believe vengeance is something what it is God's. And I strongly believe it is God who is capable of taking vengeance and not anybody else. But as far as the injustice done, when we speak of that yes, I would speak of, and I would say that I do not know why Congress Party did whatever they did. You know, it was just on a word. My father passed away. The worst part is, till my father's death, I was not even in politics. It was just in 2009, I was first time brought into politics. I became an MP, and within 100 days, my father passed away. And at just at that instance, when my father passed away, within 15-20 days after that incident, I happened to go to that place where the chopper crash took place. It was a hillock. So literally we had to walk up the hill for a kilometer or so and visit that site. And right underneath that hillock, we had this huge condolence meeting for my dad also taking place there. So I walked up and I saw the chopper pieces there, and then I was walking down, and people who were with me, the topic of conversation then was that so many people had passed away unable to bear the death of my father. A lot of them out of shock, some of them committed suicide, and there were around about 700-800 people who passed away. So that was the topic of discussion while we were coming down. So that was playing in my mind. And in that condolence meeting what took place, I spoke. I had to speak, so I spoke. And I just made a statement that I will come and visit every house what had given up their lives for my dad, unable to bear his death, unable to bear the shock. I just thought it was an emotional statement. I never knew that we had to take somebody's permission to make such kind of a statement. I was new to Congress Party myself. And it was just that one word what I gave then, what was, you know, at my father's crash site I gave a word. And the Congress Party did not want me to continue with that word. I do not know for what reason. And that was something emotional. And for 6 months, I tried to prevail with everybody in Congress. I would have probably met Sonia Gandhi at least thrice. I would have probably met Ahmed Patel ji at least 6-7 times. And I tried to prevail on them to grant me permission to go. I never even knew that you had to take somebody's permission for that. But once the situation started becoming clearer that I need to take somebody's permission, so I went and I asked. For 6 months I tried to prevail on them, and yet whenever I went, they used to always say, postpone it, postpone it, postpone it.
What was their objection?
Nothing. I don't know. They will not speak of their objection. 6 months they kept postponing. And then after 6 months, I said, enough is enough. This is a word what I had given at my father's crash site. And if I don't honor the word, my father had a reputation that he stands on a word. And if I, being his son, having given a word at my father's crash site, if I were to not honor the very word what I had given there, then what kind of a human being am I? So I pushed. And then these Congress people from Delhi tried to stop. And basically, you know, the locations were, you know, obviously the entire state. I can't fly in a chopper, so I need to take a car. I need to go to every house there. So when I go there, literally people were stopping me in every village en route.
And why was that happening? Did you never find out?
No, that was a legend. Whether Congress Party acknowledges or not, it's still a fact that maybe Gandhiji's have a certain grace with the people, maybe all over the country. But as far as Andhra is concerned, my father was also somebody. He had a legacy also.
So you're saying because his name was larger than the Gandhi's name?
That apparently is the only thing what it all translates to. Because I was traveling from every village en route I was stopped. You know, in fact, every village I was stopped where Dad's statue was coming up, where the entire village was coming out to greet me, to ensure that Dad's statue came up there. And I used to garland Dad's statue there, and then I used to go to another village, and then same thing again happening there. And then I used to go visit every house. This Congress did not like it. They said call everybody to one single location in that district and just finish whatever help you want to do. I asked them, did they ask me for any help? Nobody asked me for any help. I'm doing out of my own heart saying I wanted to do it. So I gave a word. Unfortunately, I never even knew that this word would cost me something. But I gave a word, and then I'm just fulfilling the very word what I had given.
In your personal meetings, when you went and met Sonia, was Rahul Gandhi ever present there?
No, I couldn't. I never met
Rahul Gandhi. And was Sonia Gandhi, in your personal interaction, your mother was with you, was she respectful to your mother? How did those meetings go on?
See, towards the end, you know, the situation was turning very ugly. Like, you know, I was going. The Congress High Command literally used to prevail on the ministers, on the MLAs, and say and give instructions, and the MPs and give instructions not to participate, not to join me there. So the situation was very ugly, because, you know, I was going, people were with me, crowds were coming, villages, every village, people were stopping.
Initially, everything was all right when you met her, but it was only when you went to meet these families that things turned ugly.
For 6 months, I was asking for permission, yet they did not give. Then I pushed. When I started pushing, they literally came all out and, you know, did everything what they should not have done to literally stop me from going. Then finally a stage had come when I saw the ugliness of it, myself, my mother and my sister, all of us asked for an appointment with Sonia Gandhi, and we literally went there and said, we asked, please give us permission to go. This is all what we ask. And she met my mother and my sister separately, me separately. And then she tried to tell them that I'm going to make him a central ministry, later I'm going to make him a chief minister, but ask him not to go. And then she told me the same. But then they were not willing to let me go. So then a situation came where after the meeting, myself, my mother and my sister, we came here. And three women in my family, what mattered to me the most, my wife, my sister and my mother, we had a discussion, and I told them that if I don't do this, maybe I would be made a minister, maybe I would be made a chief minister later, but I would be dishonoring my father's word given at my father's crash site. So I was very new to politics. I said destiny.
So basically it was over you not being made chief minister that you fell off.
No, this was never about politics. It was never about chief ministry. It was never about central ministry. It was never about politics. It is just about a word. And they somehow wanted me not to do it.
And when you left Congress?
I literally went, but the topic of discussion to it, by the end of it, between my mother, sister, my wife and myself was, if I stay there, I'm going to be made a central minister and later a chief minister as well. But if I were to differ, I would be honoring my father's path. These are the two options what I have. So what do I do? And finally, I took a decision and said, I'm taking this path. And my wife, my first sister, my mother, all of them supported me. They said, okay, fine. So at that stage, it was like political oblivion. You know, you're fighting against somebody in Delhi, you're fighting against somebody in the state. Both of them, they're ruling. You have nobody with you. Literally, you will be like contesting as an independent when you tender resignation to the party. But yet we decided, let it be political oblivion.
And then the 16 months in jail?
It was little later. Then at that stage we decided that we still take this option, even if it's going to be a harder route, even if it's going to be filled with the difficulties, I said, at least even if it's going to mean political oblivion, let's do it. At least let's be remembered in history as somebody who stood for a word. And then we tendered our resignation. Our resignation was accepted over the phone. Forget about speaker calling us. Over the phone, the resignation was accepted. And then and then immediately by-elections were also called. I had no symbol, I had no party. It was literally like contesting as an independent. 14 days is all what I had for the symbol to penetrate. And the entire cabinet ministers from the state were camped there. My family was also split. My uncle was made a central state minister, and he was also pitched against my mother. And they did everything what they should not have done. And then, but yet, ultimately, in spite of all the odds, God was with us.
And today, and where is the Congress in Andhra Pradesh?
God was with us. God was with us, and we triumphed with 5,45,000 majority. What was the tallest on the 14th Lok Sabha? That was God's grace. So when you're doing something right, God always supports. And then they could not bear that. Somebody coming with 5,45,000 majority, the tallest in the 14th Lok Sabha, they could not bear that. And then TDP and Congress came together, filed petitions against me. You know the petitioners in my case? You know who the petitioners are? None other than TDP people, TDP leaders, and none other than Congress leaders are petitioners in my case.
So TDP, you are saying, was in an alliance with the BJP, but then, for you, they were with the Congress.
Then the petitioners were TDP leaders and the Congress leaders together. They came, they filed petitions. After my father's death, after I left the Congress party, after I was becoming a political force to reckon with, they could not just tolerate it. Then they came all out with vengeance, filed cases together. Then Telugu Desam and TDP supported Congress Chief Minister. There was, you know, this Kiran Kumar Reddy's government went ahead and, you know, jacked up the prices of the power. When that happened, we moved no confidence motion. Telugu Desam Party, even though it was the opposition, even though it was the main opposition party, it issued a whip to protect Kiran's government, to protect Congress government. Such was the understanding with which they worked. And then the rest, of course, you were all with.
Are you saying the BJP didn't see through this?
I don't know, Kacha. Chandrababu Naidu is godless. He can do anything with anybody.
So, Mr. Jagan Reddy, I want to ask you, what do you think of Rahul Gandhi? He is seen as the major challenger to Prime Minister Narendra Modi at a national level. He's come out with his best-seller scheme, which is going to be a game-changer, the Nyuntam Aay, the basic minimum income guarantee scheme. What do you think about this scheme, and do you think this is going to tilt voters in one particular direction?
Basically, you know, whatever Rahul Gandhi spoke about, be it this minimum income guarantee scheme, what you speak of, or the debt waiver to the farmers, what he earlier spoke of, all these schemes are really good schemes, there's no doubt about it. But then one should have the sincerity to do it well. You know, as far as this minimum guarantee scheme you just spoke about, as far as this scheme is concerned, what does the scheme say? It says the scheme is given to anybody whose income is less than 12,000 per month. The scheme is given to anybody, and the amount so given would be 6,000 rupees to that person whose income is less than 12,000 rupees per month. But the arithmetic is wrong. But the entire arithmetic is wrong. He spoke about 5 crore people who would be eligible for this, and he spoke about 25 crore families who would benefit from it, and he said 20% of the population would be covered. But that is where the arithmetic is wrong. See, I'll tell you, I'll give you a brief example of my state. See, it's not 20%, it's the other way around. 80% of the population in India, I can definitely say Andhra Pradesh, is having income less than 12,000 per month.
80%?
I'll give you a briefing of my own state. See, my own state has approximately 1.7 crore 1.7 crore ration cards. Out of this 1.7 crore ration cards, approximately 1.4 crore ration cards, meaning to say 1.4 crores into 3 people per family, even average if you were to take. You're seeing 1.4 into 3 is 4.2 crore population. Our Andhra Pradesh state has got a population of 5 crores. So in a 5 crore population, 4.2 crore population have income, have BPL cards, have below poverty line white cards. That means in villages their income is less than 5,000 rupees per month, 60,000 per annum. And in urban centers it is 6,000 per month or 72,000 rupees per annum. So 80% of the population is having income less than 12,000. So if this is reality, how do you justify and say that this scheme is applicable only to 20% of the people? See, the arithmetic should always be, it should always be done with sincerity to help people in a saturation mode. So you should not just do anything for the sake of doing it. No, it should deliver. When you speak of numbers, when you speak of calculations, your calculations should be very precise. Only when you think that, you know, you can do this scheme to meet the needs of 80% of the population, then you come forward and
so make you're an saying this scheme doesn't really cover the kind of India it should.
It obviously doesn't, and I'm giving you an example of my own state. If that scheme would cover 1.4 crore people in my state, 1.4 crore families, that is in my state, meaning to say 4.2 crore people in my state, that is 80% of my state, I'd be more than happy. But then if it just covers only 20% of my people, then the whole scheme falls short. Whole scheme falls
it's a
flat.
Sham.
It doesn't look sincere, that's what I'm trying to say. But by and large, the thinking is good. I mean, to do something like this is good. Debt waiver to farmers, it's good. But you should have the arithmetics to match them. You should do the math right. And you should have the sincerity in the heart to do good, to deliver right.
So Mr. Jagan Reddy, where do you stand today as far as alliances are concerned? There is a Mahagathbandhan. There are disparate parties like Chandrababu Naidu's TDP, Mamata Banerjee, Akhilesh Yadav, there is Naveen Patnaik. There are so many of these regional parties that are talking. You have expressed a lot of solidarity with KCR. You two somewhere stand together. Are you going to be part of this Mahagathbandhan, or do you think both of you have the propensity to really veer towards the BJP and Narendra Modi as the leader?
As far as we are concerned, let me speak of my state first. See, we have 25 MPs in our state. And God willing, touch wood, we sweep the state.
How many are you saying? How
God willing, your own surveys speak of those numbers. I did not explicitly speak of those numbers because it would sound very, very arrogant on my part to speak of those numbers beforehand. But definitely, even if your numbers, what your survey speaks of, presuming that those numbers come, so it's a sizable, good number, big number. What this number, our demand would only be, you sign special category status, and we are with them. Whomsoever it might be.
You'll trust the Congress if they promise you that?
Here, there is no element of trusting anybody there. Here, the element is coming into the picture because we don't trust anybody. We're saying you sign, then we support. Because this is coming out of mistrust. This is not coming out of trust. It's coming out of mistrust. But as far as KCRG is concerned, in fact, I'm very thankful to him. In fact, he is one person who has come forward, stood up for the cause of special category status. I mean, even though he's not from my state, he said he pledged his entire 17 member of parliaments for the special category status. I mean, with 25 from my end, from our state, with 17 MPs coming from Telangana state, with 42 MPs demanding for special category status, speaking in high tone that this injustice be corrected, a word what was given in the parliament be honored. With 42 members coming together and demanding this special category status, it would become imperative for whomsoever who's forming the government at Delhi, you know, to literally take a serious look and yield to special category status demand.
Who's going to make a better Prime Minister? Rahul Gandhi, who's now contesting from Amethi and Wayanad in Kerala, or Narendra Modi? Who has the capacity to lead this country for the next 5 years?
See, as far as I'm concerned,
And you're an educated man. Don't just look at Andhra Pradesh. You've said what you want for Andhra Pradesh, but beyond Andhra Pradesh is your country, our country. What do you think about the country?
Maybe in a countrywide, if you were to look at it from a country's perspective, maybe Modi ji has probably exhibited a stronger will. I would say that. But definitely as far as Andhra Pradesh state is concerned, what I definitely would have to come back to, both of them have betrayed our state. This is something what I need to speak.
And what do you think of Rahul Gandhi contesting from two seats and one being a Hindu minority seat?
Well, it certainly gives a feeling that, you know, he's not secured with his seat in Amethi. That is what the outside perception what he gives. But of course, these are their own calculation, and I would not be in a position to judge their calculations.
Mr. Jagan Reddy, I want to go back to the 16 months that you spent in jail. Between then, what went through your mind, and between that being translated to the Padyatra that you undertook and the crowds that you are getting today, what's the man Jagan Reddy's thought process in jail and today?
So basically, when you do injustice to somebody, when that somebody is put behind bars for no reason of his, I was neither an MP, neither an MLA when my father was the Chief Minister. I never set my foot in the Secretariat, neither did I speak to a minister, neither did I know a minister, neither did I speak to an IAS officer, neither did I know an IAS officer. I was not even in Hyderabad. I was in Bangalore with my children doing my own business. I have a 40 megawatt hydropower project in Karnataka then as well, even before my father became the Chief Minister. And I was a businessman there in my own right, and I was just there. And I was not even in politics, neither an MP nor MLA. And just because I differed with somebody politically, people come together, Congress, Telugu Desam Party leaders, they become the petitioners, they file cases, and then they take it to another level. They try to harass people because somebody is growing politically, they don't want it to happen. And then they are put behind bars. And for anybody, a bail is something what is mandatorily given. When somebody is not proven guilty, it is the democracy what says that within 3 months you're supposed to give bail. This is a democratic right. If you're put behind bars, all of a sudden somebody comes and throws you behind bars, and within 3 months it is your democratic right to be granted a bail because nobody has proven you guilty, and yet you were denied bail. For 16 months, you're put behind bars.
You blame the Congress for that?
I blame Telugu Desam Party as well as Congress for that, both of them.
They were manipulating the judicial system?
These people talk about that is what the irony is. These people talk about manipulating agencies today as though it's a big crime. And what did they do then? in my case. See, people in power should never become arrogant. See, people in power should always know and understand that there is God who is above them watching.
And you think the Congress party leadership was arrogant?
It is basically for anybody to judge. No, you're not supposed to treat somebody like that. Even you're not even supposed to treat your enemy like that.
And mentally, what did you go through?
See, obviously there was a lot of trauma, you know, the entire family, the kids. They've seen my father, the chief minister, and suddenly their father, chief minister's son, suddenly put behind bars. They go to the schools, children speak about it. And it affects the entire family. You can't just do something like that to a person.
And that hurt you?
See, basically, you know, these kind of things. See, I depend a lot on God. I literally I pray every day and I ask for mental peace and I always have God before me. So I don't keep anything in my heart. I leave it to God for His own wisdom to do whatever He pleases. But definitely at that stage I was hurt, definitely. But now things have changed and we have bigger things to worry about, our state most importantly. And our
did that
primarily.
Period give you the resolve to come out and fight back?
Absolutely. In fact, you know, if somebody is put behind bars, even if you hit a cat, you put a cat in a room and you start hitting that cat every day, you would find that cat one day retaliating.
Is that why becoming Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh is something that really is your ambition today?
Me becoming Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh is for something else. It's because, you know, I have a legacy. People have seen my father and I wanted to be better than him. People have seen my father and I've seen my father stay alive after death. And my objective and my goal is to stay alive after death. That is my objective of coming into politics or being into politics or doing whatever I am in politics. God willing, one day, God would give me that opportunity.
The Congress that tried to break your spirit says it's a very democratic party and has called Narendra Modi Hitler. What would you say to them today?
That's what I said. These people speak about democracy. When they were in power, they were so arrogant that they exactly did whatever they're speaking, what is not right today. So anyway,
karma.
Okay.
God decides. Well, it's been a pleasure, Jagan Reddy. I hope we had more time, but we do hope we'll catch up soon on the day, on May 23rd, when results are declared. We hope you'll get to the ambition that you have held so close to your heart, and you will give us another opportunity to speak at that time.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining.